Hi, we're just running a few minutes late while we let everybody sign in.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for all coming here today. We're excited to have you. We're going to go through the presentation for the Congressional Act Challenge, and then we'll have a Q&A session after. So if you have any questions, we'll open up the floor. I'm going to go ahead and let Rhiannon start off, and then we'll introduce ourselves.
Hi, so my name is Rhiannon Anderson. Can you all hear me okay? All right, thank you all so much for being here. We really appreciate it. My name is Rhiannon Anderson. I am the executive director of this project for the Internet Education Foundation, which is the non-governmental sponsor of this competition. Melissa Medina.
So my name is Melissa. You have probably received my email or got my email forwarded to you, which is why you're here today. I am the Congressional Affairs Director for the Congressional Act Challenge. Little bit of background, I used to work on the Hill. I actually did my bosses at the time, the first year Congressional Act Challenge. So I totally understand where you're coming from. I understand the questions that you had. For this year, we tried to make it as easy as possible for your offices to launch and host a challenge. So let me know if you have any questions moving forward. So to just get started, this year, the Congressional Act Challenge, going through the agenda, we'll do the introductions, and we'll go over the rules, which, just heads up, I know a couple of you guys have been following, waiting for the rules to be finalized by the Committee on House Administration. They have been finalized and passed. So yay, this is why we're allowed to have the Congressional Act Challenge happen this year. We're going to go through the quick timeline, the submission process, so what the offices have to do, and then what the students have to do. We'll go over what your office has to do to prep for launch, which is November the 9th, next week, Monday, and then next steps, and then also the resources we've provided for offices to help you guys make this process easy. So just to do a quick background, in case you're wondering, what is the Congressional App Challenge? The Congressional App Challenge is an app competition where it's hosted by members of Congress on the House side. It's to basically help inspire high school students to get involved in computer science and STEM-related fields. So just like how the art competition is held in the district with high school students, this is like the art competition, but for STEM education. And it's a great way for members of Congress who are interested in engaging with their constituents on science and tech to do something about it and actually engage with students in high school. It's again for all high schools where districts are participating. I underline participating because it means that offices who are interested and want their students to enroll or submit an app, they must be signed up to participate, which is why the main thing in this, if there is a takeaway from today, please, if your office is interested, make sure you sign up with the Internet Education Foundation. Sign up to let us know your office is interested in participating so that we can start the challenge for you guys and basically create a platform where you're going to send the students to submit their application. If your office does not sign up to participate, students in your district cannot participate. So that's something that I want to underline.
Do we have to sign up by the 9th, or can we sign up, like, say, within 3 weeks, our boss decides not to participate?
So, just to repeat what she just said for the people watching remotely and for anybody who might not have heard, the question was, do you have to sign up by the 9th? And the answer to that is no. We do recommend it. However, we understand that, you know, a district might not be participating until a student says to them, hey, I do want to do this, why aren't you signed up? And it is for that reason that we have set it up so that you can let us know almost until the very end. We don't recommend doing that. That will make it a lot harder, but yeah, you can sign up whenever you like.
One more question, and then we'll get on with the presentation, but then we'll also open it up to question and answer at the end. Go ahead.
Sorry. So you mentioned that it's open to high school students whose high schools are in the district. Let's say the student in our district, that their high school is in a district where they're, who is not participating, can they submit to us?
Yes, and so we're going to get to that. question, but just really quickly, the student is eligible if they, one, live in your district, and two, if they go to a school in your district. They can choose which member of Congress or which district to submit their app in, but they can only choose one. They cannot hedge their bets and do two members of Congress hoping to win. They must choose one. And in terms of the Congressional App Challenge, so it first came to inception in 2013. Its first year was in 2014 last year, so this is the second year that they're hosting the Congressional App Challenge. It is the first year that the Internet Education Foundation is the non-governmental sponsor. So just like how the art competition has an outside organization helping members of Congress offices coordinate that, this year we have IEF, and that's why Rhiannon and I are here, is to help every office launch the competition and make it successful. Quick note, last year for those of your offices who hosted the STEM competition before, that's what it was called. Moving forward, it's the Congressional App Challenge. One thing I do want to go ahead and note is for this year we have brand new congressional co-chairs, and they are Representative Mimi Walters and Representative Hakeem Jeffries. And for today, we actually have a member of Representative Hakeem Jeffries' office, and that's Elaine Jin. So come say hi to her. She will be one of the point of contacts in Congress if you have any questions. And Casey Fitzpatrick is in Representative Mimi Walters' office. I'm not sure if he's here, but if he isn't, you may be getting to your colleagues from either Elaine or Casey. So keep a note of those names. And we're really excited to have them as our co-chairs. So nitty-gritty things, the rules. Biggest points to note is, again, students are only eligible in districts that have signed up. Key takeaway, if you're interested, please sign up because your students will not be able to enter. Another point, students must be in high school and must be over the age of 13, or must be 13 on or by November the 9th. So that is important in terms of age. They may compete as an individual or a team of up to four. Something, if there are students who want to do a team, within the team, at least a minimum of two students must be qualified in the district that they are submitting an app in. So if you have a team of three, two out of the three have to qualify in your district. What that means is two out of the three must either be in a high school in your district or must live in your district. And then participating congressional offices, this is important to note, may not use campaign funds to support this officially sanctioned competition. Second part of the rules is that, again, committee passed the committee resolution 114, so if you actually need hard rules and want to refer to the legislation that created this, it's the Committee on House Administration Committee Resolution 114. And you can also find it on our tool guide or our toolkit, which is on page 23. And you can find our toolkit on the Congressional App Challenge website. So if you go there, you go to resources, then you look at our toolkit. This toolkit has everything that you would need, including all of the rules laid out. Last part in terms of rules is what can your offices spend on in terms of this challenge? So the MRA is okay for franking. It's okay for having staff allocated to this challenge, both either in the district and in DC, either or. Website and social media, advertisements, but just make sure, again, it's compliant with the handbook. So you can do it on Facebook, you can do it on Twitter if you guys want to buy ad buys, but again, make sure it's compliant with the handbook. If you have an event and you want to purchase food and beverages, you're okay to do that. Rental for the room, let's say you guys have a demo day at the end of your, at the end of the Congressional Challenge and you want to do a demo day and host it at let's say the Richard Nixon Library where they usually, you know, cost, you guys are able to spend for that as long as it's compliant with the handbook. Any gifts and donations that are compliant with the handbook are also okay. So the basic gist, you can run the competition, know the handbook. Next, in terms of milestones, these are the key dates that your offices will have to know. November the 9th, next Monday, that's the date in which the submission period opens up and students can start to submit their apps. It doesn't mean that they have to start submitting it November the 9th. They have until January the 15th, which is the deadline for the submission period. And again, just to touch on a point that somebody had asked, an office can sign up after November the 9th. After the after the submission period ends January the 15th, we will provide your offices with the submissions, and then February the 12th is when the office has to have the winner submitted to IEF, us. So your offices will be in charge of, one, picking the winner, and working with the judges who you guys will deem, and I'll get into that in a little bit. But two, the follow-up is to send your winners to IEF, because we're gonna add it on our website so that everybody knows who the winners are nationally. And then also we're gonna arrange to ensure that your winners are featured on the display, which is down by Canon. And who here has seen the display by Canon where they show the apps? So it's like a 3-pane panel television, and it's right after you go through all of the artwork in the Canon tunnel. If you ever need to stop by and check it out, it's over there. And then the end date is, we will announce all the winners nationally February the 22nd. And we'll have that up on our website. You guys can also start doing your press releases for your final winners and announce it then. That February the 22nd is the end.
You might notice that date has changed if you've been looking at things. We had it on February the 15th, and then it was pointed out to us that is President's Day. So we pushed it back a little bit just so that nobody would have to announce on President's Day.
And again, submission period.
That says October 26th. It's November 9th. October 26th. Yeah.
October is on. So it's November the 9th to January the 15th. So now the question that offices have been asking is, so how are students supposed to submit? Is our office supposed to accept all of these? Is the point person supposed to go through all the students? Brief answer, no. We've made it easy for you guys to basically send your students to the platform challenge.gov. And that's where you will send the students to go ahead and submit their apps. Challenge.gov is going to be the website where the students will, one, go to and register, and then two, be able to find an individual page that we are creating for each of your offices. So the student will go to challenge.gov, find your member's individual page that we will create by the launch date, and that they will be able to submit on.
To clarify, if you've already signed up, we will create the page for you by launch day. So if you sign up on November 9th, we will make it as quickly as we can. But if you haven't signed up yet, your page will probably not be ready by November 9th.
Yes. So quick step, basically send them to challenge.gov, and challenge.gov will be live November the 9th. And we will be sending, for the participating offices who sign up before then, the link to your page by that morning. In terms of the submission process now and this is just an example of how the member of Congress's will look like. There'll be a couple examples, and students can go ahead and choose which of their member, basically find their member. And in terms of each office, the one thing that we want to stress is make sure when you're telling your students to go to challenge.gov, you need to stress that they need to find your member's page. Because when they submit it, they need to submit it to your member's page. What that does is it packages everybody in your district in one area. So at the end, January 15th comes along. Within the next week, we can just send that straight to you guys, and you will have everybody who is eligible in your district sent to you. It will also be filtering through, let's say there's somebody not in your district who accidentally submits on your page. We have a form that's going to ask them a couple questions to verify eligibility. So we have that in there. Another thing is in the search tool, they can search either your member's name, the district that they're in. So there are different ways in which they can find your member's page. In terms of the student process, so that you guys understand too where the students are coming from and what they're going to go through, the submission process, step one, will be you direct them to challenge.gov. Step two is that they register on challenge.gov in the right member's page, and that they fill out the contact info link, which will be included there. Three is they'll create the app. Four is they submit the app on challenge.gov. And five is that there's going to be an exit form that we're going to have on the Congressional App Challenge.us website that'll just ask them a couple questions at the end. So it's pretty much a five-step process for the students. Let us know if you have any questions. For everybody who's also curiously writing, we're going to post this up too, and you'll have access to both the video and the slides. So don't worry about getting everything down. So January 15th comes, then what? IAF will go ahead and send your offices the apps that are submitted in and send you the contact information for your office. We'll also have the option where for judges, if you guys choose your judges and you want to let us know who they are and you want us to just send the judges the apps, we can do that too. And then the judging period begins. I'll cover the judging period in a couple of slides, but that's pretty much what happens. We package it off, you know who the applicants are, and you'll have all of that done and sorted. In terms of the sign up to participate portion, so now prepare to launch, what do? Make sure you sign up, fill out the Google form. Next, for offices who haven't yet done this or started, make sure you start reaching out to local high schools. Some of the questions we've been getting is, where do we start? Check with any high schools that have STEM-related programs or direct, science or computer science programs. Those tend to have really good returns in terms of students who would be interested, and teachers that you can reach out to let their students know. Another thing is identify any local partners that you can reach out to let them know, hey, we're doing this competition. Do you know students who would be interested? An example would be a nonprofit organization that's local in your district, and they teach students how to code after school. Reach out to them and see if any of them or any of their students would be interested to participate. In terms of criteria for best practices, that will be shared with you guys throughout. And then what's optional is you can plan for a kickoff event. And that's what a couple offices are doing, whether that be just a quick press event, but offices have started to plan that. So that may be something you can think of. And it doesn't have to be on November the 9th. If your office decides to do that a week later, feel free to do that as well. In terms of office to-dos beforehand, with regards to your website, make sure that on your website somewhere you have a tab that says Congressional App Challenge and has the details of the app challenge on there.
Is anyone from Donna Edwards' office here?
Shout out to you guys. This is an awesome page, and we just wanted to highlight that as that's an example on there. It basically just has, the representative is participating again this year. And now that we have all the information for you, you can put the submission dates on there. You can say once you have an app, direct them over to challenge.gov. And once we provide you with the individual link to your member, you can post that on there too. Now for launch day, what do you do when November the 9th comes along? Sending out a press release is an idea. We highly suggest and encourage that for your boss. Doing a kickoff event is optional. That's something that offices are thinking of doing. And then using social media to the extent possible. The hashtag that we are using is #CAC15. That'll just help with any of the storify that we do and basically aggregating all of the tweets that go out or Instagram pictures. One thing that we do suggest too is if you guys are working with schools and some schools decide that their whole class is going to work on this, since your office is probably not going to be there with the school every day and checking in, let them know about this hashtag and tell them to interact with your member, taking pictures of when they are working on it in their computer lab. And that's a great way to, one, get feed for your office, but also promote the Congressional App Challenge as well. So basically, raise awareness would be what happens after the challenge is launched. Make sure you continue to outreach to schools, continue to find local partners, and attend any STEM events that are in your district where students may be interested in this, and you can promote the Congressional App Challenge. So in terms of the judging period and judging in general, for the judging period, it's going to happen after the submission period ends. So January 15th until February the 5th, your judges and your office will get the apps that we get on the challenge.gov platform. We'll send it to you guys or the judges, whatever you guys let us know you prefer. And then through that time period, your judges have 3 weeks to get through the app submissions. Offices who have 5 apps, offices who have 20, you guys have each 3 weeks. So that's just something to keep in mind and to tell your judges. The judges will submit to you their winner on February the 5th, and then your office has the final say and has a week to review who your judges chose as winners. We want to be sure that your office, one, has that final filter, just in case there's an app that, yes, was super clever and the judges thought it was awesome, but is not necessarily appropriate, and you guys would not want to go ahead and advertise that on a national scale. We leave it to your office to have that final discretion. And then the final point, send us your winner February the 12th, and then we will announce on the national scale on the 22nd of February next year. In terms of judging, offices will select their own local judges. The guidance that we give is that please make sure that your judges are impartial and fair. And for criteria, be sure that, one, we have suggested 3 criteria points, quality of the idea, the implementation of the idea, and then the demonstrated coding skills. We understand that some offices want to be flexible and add a couple things. Feel free to do that. We have left it very flexible for offices because we understand that there are a lot of levels of coding. Some districts may have more novice students. Others may have ones who have completely finished an app and turned that in. We leave it up to you to decide on the criteria. Guidance is just have an odd number of judges, and also make sure that when you're looking at it, you guys can make your own scale. So if it's 1 to 5, 1 to 10, we leave that up to you. Winners being announced, some guidance on that is make sure you let us know. Also, your office can go ahead and issue a press release. You can post the winner up on your website. We'll post it on ours. And then in terms of social media, use that to your advantage. Throughout the competition and for the next 10 weeks, we will be also sending best practices and highlights of offices that are doing awesome events, awesome press coverage. We'll send that to you so that you know what other offices are doing. And also, what we need from that is if your office is doing something like a workshop or a hackathon or you're doing outreach in the district, send us anything that you have. We'd love to highlight your office. In terms of support, we understand too that there are a lot of offices, this is their first time doing it, or there are some offices who did it last time, but this is a new process and you're a new staffer. We will be holding continuous check-ins every 2 weeks with an email from me, just seeing how it's going. And then once a month until the end, we'll do a conference call. So if your office is having any problems, any questions, I'll be able to go ahead and address that. And we want to just be as responsive to your office as possible. Now you're asking, what do we have in store for you to make your lives easier? We've created a toolkit that will enable your office to have everything you would need in this packet. Again, it's on our Congressional, it's on the Congressional App Challenge website. Make sure you check it out, what's in it, the background of what the Congressional App Challenge is, the rules and process detail and outline on there if you need a copy of that. Best practices already in terms of different templates, like the one-pager that you would send to, or the one-page letter that you would send to schools letting them know that this is happening, we have that drafted. We also have an example press release drafted with the details and dates that you need that your comms director can work off of. These are things that we realize offices don't need to recreate. If it's the same information, you can add your twist and the quote from your member, but we've already created the body template that you guys can feel free to use. And then you can download that packet, again, on our Congressional App Challenge website. Other things that we've created for your office are promotional tools. The one-page handout that you can hand out to students. We've done that for you, and you can find that on our website as well. You can change hosted by and then representative so-and-so, or Congresswoman so-and-so is hosting this. We've left that template for you to fill in, but we've kept all of the other guidelines and questions the same, since it's the same for every office. We've also provided resources in terms of announcing the Congressional App Challenge on social media. We have these templates that are made for graphics. Feel free to use them as much as you want, especially on the launch date. That's also available for download on our website. And pretty much that is the wrap-up of our overview, and we're going to open it up for questions. We're really excited that your offices are interested. We're excited for this turnout. Again, it's the second year, so we're interested to see this grow. If you have any questions, feel free to contact me. I will be the point of contact for every office, and my name is Melissa. If you haven't yet, my cards are up there. Feel free to grab it. I also have my cards up here, and you'll be most likely getting an email from me. So don't get annoyed and make sure you open it throughout the rest of the 10 weeks. So thank you, and Brianna, do you have anything else before we open it up that will allow any individuals who need to leave to leave?
Thank you all for coming.
If you don't have questions, it's cool, but if you have questions and need to stay, we're going to open it up for question and answer. Okay, so that we don't take up too much overhead. So don't take too much of your time. Any specific questions that your offices have? Yes?
With respect to intellectual property, apps that are created are owned by the creators, right?
Yes. So the question was, in respect to intellectual property, are the apps created owned by the owners, the students? Yes, they are.
But we put in the terms and conditions that by submitting the app, the student understands that we will be posting their app, number one, on our website, but number two, it will be put on that display that's under the canon. So yes, they own it, but they also give the offices certain rights to display those for at least a calendar year following the conclusion of the challenge.
The one thing with that as well is, let's say the student had created the app already, and because the rule is a student can submit the app into your competition as long as it was built within the calendar year of the start of the challenge. So if the student built it 6 months ago, they can submit it. Let's say the student submitted it already on iTunes or Android because they're that awesome, but they sell it for like 99 cents. During the duration of the challenge, it cannot be of cost. So that needs to be something that if a student had created it already, publicized it, and posted it on the Apple or on the Apple platform or Android platform or whatever platform they're using, it cannot be charged during the time of the challenge. So that's just one point to make. Students cannot be making money off of this. Thanks.
Where offices sign up is that at congressionalappchallenge.us?
Yeah, so at congressionalappchallenge.us, there's a tab that says Congressional Offices. It's super clear, like, this is for you. And if you click that tab, the first option is office sign up. So you just go there, you fill out a form. The only information we need from you is your office, your member, a contact person in the DC office, and a contact person in the district office. So sign up is a super simple process.
Yeah.
Can both public and private schools participate in the
challenge? Absolutely. Any student, the only rules about the students is that they have to be turning 13 on November 9th, 2015, or earlier, and they have to either reside within the district or be eligible to attend high school in the district. So if they are attending high school in that district, they can compete in that district. Kids who are homeschooled, of course, can also compete in the district in which they reside.
Yes.
Hi, I do apologize. I was a little late, but do you all
have a resource page that we will be building out.
Okay.
We are hosting the challenge. We are not, there are organizations that entire goal is to teach coding. That's not what we're doing. We would like to build out that aspect of the challenge. It's unlikely that we'll be able to do that in great depth this year. However, we do, on the website, there's a tab that says compete and it says resources. The kid can go, we have a bunch of links, and it says, here are links that you can use. Currently, they are all free links. I think we might post links to like Udemy, which have both free and paid classes. But yes, those things do exist. And the whole point is to get kids who have never coded anything to learn how to code. So we absolutely want kids who have never done anything to try and learn.
And just really quickly to that point, this is the website, and in terms of the resources that we have, if you click on there, you can tell the students to go there. And for students, we have the list of development kit and like tutorials where it's free to use, and then you can go ahead and send them to do that.
Thank you for that question. By or on November 9th. At the beginning of the competition, they have to be 13 years of age.
Oh, gotcha. And one more thing is that I think you mentioned you can send them to the website and have the individual member pages. Will there be static links for those individual member pages so we can just link them directly?
Yes, and we will send those to you. So essentially, it takes a lot of back-end infrastructure for someone to submit the code necessary. And to clarify, one thing we did talk about, but it's made very clear on the website, the student has to submit the code to their app, but they also have to submit a video because we understand that kids can create apps on different platforms like Samsung or Android or Apple, and the judge might only have an iPhone, so they won't be able to open that up on their phone. So the kid submits a video as well explaining it. So we will make the kid can see all this stuff on congressionalappchallenge.us, but challenge.gov is the infrastructure to let the kids submit the actual code and their video. So we will make an individual page for every person or every member that's participating. We will give you that link. You can put it on your own website. You can put it on that nice page that I saw you already have. And we'll give you all that information. We'll also post it on our website. The kids should have no problem finding their particular district.
What's entailed for like district staff with this?
It depends on how much effort you want to put into it. We hope that the people in the district will at the very least be contacting their local high schools, letting them know. We know a couple of districts are planning on hosting their own hackathons, hosting their own events. I mean, you get out of it what you put into it. So if we purposely plan this thing not to overlap with the Congressional Art Challenge, because we did want to put extra work on staff. It'll be at least a couple of hours a week, but if the person wants to put more into it, that would be fantastic.
And we do highly suggest too that the district staff, if they can, get involved, because a lot of the times what we've seen with offices is the district staff is the one who runs the art competition and already has those ins with high schools. So if they just already know that high school have a relationship with the principal or teachers there, this is just another way to be like, hey, we're also doing this, except it's more focused in on science and tech. Just wanted to let you know what's going on, let your students know. But that's true.
Oh, no, sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt. No. But, going back to the static page that the members will be able to access, is that something where we can see how many students have submitted like throughout the competition, or?
So unfortunately, you will have to ask us to get that information because you have to be an administrator on challenge.gov.
Okay.
It's a balance between we want to make this as easy on you as possible and how much control you get over. So to make it easier for you, we are being the administrator, and otherwise we'd have to make 435 or plus the delegates administrators. So you will have to email either myself or Melissa and say, hey, can we just get an update? How many people do we have submitted?
Sure.
But keep in mind that if you have, no submissions up until the last week, that's also pretty reasonable. Most of these kids we expect will submit towards the close of the submission period. That's why they get 10 weeks to do it. So if you have zero in like week six, do not fret.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Who are the judges? who's judging us, and they'll pass along their choices to us for us to approve?
You get to choose your own judges. The purpose of this is to be, this is an opportunity for your offices to conduct local politics, local constituent relationships. So we are going to give you best practices on finding your own judges. So a local computer science teacher, as long as they don't have students submitting anything.
Okay.
Local entrepreneurs, local VCs, local business owners. However, for offices that for some reason cannot find a judge, have some sort of issue, we are going to have set up our own technical advisory committee, and those people will serve as emergency backup judges if for whatever reason your office can't find one. However, it's an opportunity for you guys to engage with people in your community who have an interest in this type of work.
Got it, thank you.
Any other questions?
So, because last year we had quite a poor turnout, so my question is, what happens if all the submissions are not fully functional working apps, or they don't, on the coding end, they don't work?
At the end of the day, we are executors of the challenge, but it's your challenge. So if you get 5 submissions and the submissions aren't that great, you can still choose a winner. We're not telling you that you cannot. Like, we would never say to you, no, those people aren't good enough, you can't, so just pick a winner from those. You can pick whatever winner you like, using whatever criteria you like. The things that we offer you are suggestions and best practices to make it easier. That said, we understand that last year some offices didn't have a big turnout. Part of that, I think, had to do with the fact that there wasn't like a centralized group of people who were assisting. That's our role this year, is to be here and help with things like that. So if at any point you need assistance identifying organizations in your district that can help you with this kind of thing, just let us know, and we are happy to help you with that.
The role that IEF plays in this, exactly, they send us the submissions, correct, at the end?
Yeah. And the only reason we send you the submissions is, to her question earlier, we are the administrator on challenge.gov. If we could just give you a sign-in, that would be awesome, but you can't. Challenge.gov makes us do it. So we will send it to you, just because there's no way for you to get into the back end on challenge.gov.
And then on the website, for you said we could post links for our website.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So once we've created that, the day of, maybe when we launch it,
mm-hmm.
and we send it to you.
So the challenge.gov link, we will create for you. So you sign up, we create your page for you, we give you the link, and you post the link on your page, on your social media, however you want to disseminate that.
Gotcha. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Yes. So there will be, so one repercussion of that, and it's fine if you choose to do that, that's your district. So IEF, when we award prizes, we have to fundraise in order to award prizes. So because this is the first year, that might be a little difficult. We're seeing what we can do. However, we have to distribute all prizes equally. So if you don't have a winner, if you only have entrants, which is fine, you can recognize everyone if you want to do that, it will be hard for us to say, well, which student do you, or which team do you give a prize to? For this year, it's probably not going to be a huge issue, but it is something to consider for the long term. Any other questions? We will sit here for the next, we have this room for another half hour, I want to say. So if you guys have any questions, you want to just come up and ask us individually, you're more than welcome to. Besides that, thank you all so much for attending. We really appreciate your guys' support. Thanks.
So when should the video be out? Tomorrow? Just so
yeah.
I can send it to you.
Well, probably today, but tomorrow at the latest. In fact, let me turn it off. So go ahead.
Is that PowerPoint located on your website?
Not yet, but it will be.
Okay.